The idea of the Family Justice Center has nearly become a reality in Denver as the construction and renovation of the Rose Andom Center continues. We've talked about the services that would be available, and today we talk about the bricks and mortar behind those services. Rob Moreau and Melander White Construction and Joe Levy of Oz Architecture join Denver DA Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks. Welcome to this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, we have some really great guests here today, don't we?
We do, and welcome, Tamara. It's
Thank
good to
you.
See you.
Good to see you, too. So we have Rob Moreau. Thank you for being here. And pronounce the name of the construction company. I want to make sure that's exactly right.
Melander White Construction.
Okay. Well, that was pretty close. And Joe Levy with Oz Architecture.
That's correct.
Thank you so much for being here.
Well, thank you.
We're first going to give us a little bit of background, Mitch, maybe on the Rose Andom Center. What is it and what will it do?
Well, the last time we talked about it, I think we had the mayor on, and the mayor is a partner with me and a group of people that are trying to get a Family Justice Center built in Denver. We have the partnership built, but we didn't have a home for it, and we didn't have a place to put it. And so we traded some land with Denver Public Schools. They're building an elementary school, and we are now taking one of their buildings, which is down at 1330 Fox, and we are basically remodeling it. We've taken it down to, basically, we've gutted the building, and we're in the process of building a Rose Andom, the center. And it's a three-story building. There's parking on the first floor. The second floor, hopefully, will have tenants. And then eventually the center will grow into the second floor, and then the third floor is going to be the Rose Andom Center. And it's going to be a place for victims of domestic violence, hopefully to walk in and get all the services that they need, or at least touch all those providers in the city that provide services to victims that are in that desperate time where they have suffered domestic violence, or for years they've suffered it. They have children that have lived through it. It will be the first center in the Rocky Mountain region, and there's about 80 or 90 of these across the country. Denver doesn't have one, but we need one. And so when you are building a building, and I've only ever built one other one, and that was the crime lab, you need to raise the money to do it, and then you need to make sure you have partners, the architects and the contractors, that understand what you're doing and why you're doing it. And you know, this isn't just a building, this is more than that. And we've been really lucky with these two gentlemen because they get it. And they have become partners since day one. They understand the mission of what we're trying to accomplish, and they've gone a long way to help us get to the point where we can get the doors of this center finally open.
And that's a great segue into talking with you two, the partnerships that you've offered to the district attorney and the victims and families that need a place, not just a place that's temporary, but a place that's permanent. So I understand you didn't start from scratch. You're renovating a building. Talk a little bit about that building and what it'll all consist of.
Well, you know, taking it from an old office building for the school district, the systems and items that were in there weren't necessarily what was needed for the new facility. So basically, we needed to go in and basically take everything out that was in the facility and start from scratch, leaving the shell of the building there. We're going to have all new restrooms in the facility, brand new heating and electrical systems in the facility as well, all to help out with the energy conservation of the building and to bring it up to date. So it's a modern, warm, and friendly facility.
And Joe, on the point of it being warm, as an architect, were you thinking, did you have something in mind that you wanted to have this place be a welcoming place, not looking like maybe a police station, but more of a place where people can feel safe and comfortable?
Well, certainly, yes. First of all, I'd like to reiterate what Mitch said. When we got the commission, it wasn't just the building. It really is much more than that. And you're touching on some of the points that we learned as we went along of what was important and what we really had to satisfy beyond just the physical appearance of it and also the comfort of the building. So the first thing we kind of realized was the security aspects were very important on this building. People coming to this facility had to feel secure from the minute they entered the front door and went through the whole system. So that was part of our DNA for the building. The other thing that you touched upon is we wanted it to be a very friendly and inviting place. And this isn't the place. It was an office building before that. I think it was for Metro State as a school building. It was built pretty bare bones and all that. So how could we enliven it? How could we make it a little bit more inviting, even more like a house that you might go to or a lodge or something like that? Now, the style isn't that, but with some of the materials and things, we looked at how we can do that. And finally, we're looking about how we can make collaboration work, how we can bring all these people together from the various agents, collaborate with the clients as well as with each other, and have a really nice, friendly atmosphere for you to go there, and everybody knows everybody and has lunch together, and it's just a family is what we were trying to create. So that really went beyond just, you know, what kind of carpet to use and how high the ceiling was and all that, and that was just fascinating for us to figure all that out.
Were there some challenges with the renovation?
Well, several challenges. First off, with respect to taking the systems that were in place and removing those and determining what needed to be kept that was still good with respect to the equipment and the reuse of that. Secondly, really, is once we've taken everything out of the building, now we have to adjust on a few things to say, with now seeing what we have there, how do we have to deal with the floors? How much, you know, what was underneath all the carpet? Are the floors okay? The systems that we have in the front with the glazing, we're looking at those to make sure that that's an airtight and watertight system. So there's several things that we need to do once we've uncovered everything to make sure that we put it back so that it's like a new building.
Right. Mitch, what does it mean to have this kind of facility, I shouldn't say facility, really a nice building in our community as it relates to your office?
Well, the key to this building is that it is in a centralized location when it comes to the criminal justice system. This is about a half a block from our new courthouse, which is the criminal courthouse. It's about two blocks from police headquarters. It's about four blocks from my office. Denver Health is a partner in this, and they're going to have a small clinic there. But, you know, obviously, if somebody has injuries or that something, they can get to Denver Health easy. The other part of it that was important is that it has services from buses, and that you can get down there with your kids where you don't have a car, maybe that type of thing. So, you know, all the partners are kind of centrally located in this part of Denver, and that's why this was the building. We looked at other buildings. This really was the building. It wasn't the prettiest building. I think people in the Golden Triangle would tell you the first thing they'd like us to do is redo the outside, and unfortunately that's probably the last thing we'll be able to do. I remember when they built this building in the 70s. I remember when they filmed this show, when Norm Earley was the DA in that building, and Harry Cullis, that's where you guys had your studio then. Mm-hmm. Then Denver sold it to the schools, and then the schools kind of used it as an administrative building. It has parking, which is incredibly important for our partners. So the police, domestic violence people will be there. The city attorney will have someone there. I will have someone there. And what it will be is then we are triaging the situation for the victims. And so for my office, the improvement that you have, and across the country, what they've seen is that when you get the victim the appropriate services in domestic violence, one, you help keep them alive, and two, they tend to cooperate with you more as the case proceeds through the process. When I started 30 years ago, we dismissed most domestic violence cases if the police even took a report. It was embarrassing for this city the way that we did it. But it really wasn't any different than anywhere else in the country. And what this is really the next step from where we have come, how far we've gone. This really is the next step when it comes to dealing with domestic violence in Denver, and hopefully the metropolitan area, and eventually these guys will be building centers all over the Rocky Mountain region and get a lot of work for them, because they have become experts in doing this. And you know, both of them are really downplaying their role in this. We had to raise this money. There's no government money here, unless you you know, the Attorney General did give us $1 million grant from her from one of her funds, but this has been done primarily through grants, primarily through, you know, the Anschutz Foundation and some of those people that always step up in this city. And these guys have done an incredible job in helping us raise that money. They have pulled together their teams, their subcontractors. They have told them what the mission here is. Everybody has it kind of on their radar screen that we need to do this. We need to do it in a way that we can save money, but we also need to be doing it in a way that if you can think of something that you can give to this project, you can give to it. Anybody watching this show that wants to give us money in order to get this done, we're still fundraising for this capital campaign. I can tell you how to, just call me. I'll make sure, you know, a dollar will help. We have some matching situations. If someone gives us a dollar, somebody else gives us another dollar. Rose Andom's been on the show. We know her story. She sold those McDonald's at DIA, but she's really kind of the person that got this whole ball rolling as far as financially. But these guys need a lot of credit for the work that they've done. They get it, and they've helped us a lot. And our team relies on them, and they've been great partners.
And I want to talk to you about your specific roles in just a minute. We're going to take a quick break here. We'll be talking about the Rose Andom Center here on Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. Back in a moment. Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks, and this is the part of the program where we talk about a legal term. And today's legal term is amicus brief, and it means a friend of the court. This is a non-party to a proceeding that the court permits to present its views. Tell us a little bit more about this amicus brief.
You know, it's an appellate brief that's filed by people that have an interest in what the ongoing case is, but they're not really parties to it. So the last time I remember asking the Denver District or the Colorado District Attorneys to weigh in was when the Colorado Supreme Court was going to rule on a case out of Boulder that basically said DNA wasn't admissible. And so I called the prosecutors, the organization, and said, you know, you really need to write a brief to support the fact that this is admissible. And then they were able to file that. The United States Supreme Court often has friends of the court or these kind of briefs filed. So the ACLU will file them in an issue, or, you know, maybe the Innocence Project might file one. The organization that represents police chiefs, they would then write a brief to the court. And what it does is it gives the court more information than maybe just the parties. The parties sometimes have a very limited view of the overall impact that a decision will have. And so they invite amicus briefs. They invite that. And so they really get to see the whole picture and how this will impact different organizations and different groups of people when they come down with their decision.
Okay, good to know. Thanks. So getting back to the conversation at hand, we're talking about the Rose Andom Center. We've talked on previous shows about the services that it offers, but now we're talking a little bit about just building the whole thing. Rob, tell us a little bit about your involvement and how did you get involved with this building?
Well, initially, once we were brought into the project, we have to establish what the price is for it. So I spent a lot of time working with a lot of different subcontractors and the design team to establish what the intent and cost of the project was. And, you know, from there to continually work with what's the schedule of the project, how does it all fit together, and how does it need to get funded? And taking it to that next level then, I think really we got into the point of having our heartfelt dialogue with all of our vendors and talking a little bit more and spreading the message about what's the project really about. What is the facility going to be? It's not just another construction project in Denver, but it's really a facility for the community, and we wanted to convey that message of what it was all about. And when we had that opportunity to do that, it was incredible the response that we got from all of the subcontractors, that they all wanted to help out in a certain way, whether it was donating some labor, donating some of their profits, donating materials to the project. Pretty much across the board, everybody that we've gotten involved with has helped in one way or another. So it's been a very fulfilling project with respect to what are we trying to accomplish, not just here's another project to go build, but something that we're really helping out with in the community.
So let's tell me more about that. So you talked to actual people who are going to be, say, laying down the pipes or putting in the insulation or whatever it is in construction, and they're more committed because of the mission of what's going to be going on there?
Oh yeah, totally. When they see a project that is really for the community and serves a purpose for the community, that something that's just not here and that is needed, they're all willing to help out and look in and say, what can I do to you know, is it whether it's money? We've had some companies that just want to write a check to help out. We've had others that they'll donate the concrete to the project. They'll donate the pumping of the concrete to the project, the reinforcing steel for the project, steel framing for the job, the glass that goes in, you know, across the board, everything that's part of building and construction, everybody has come to the table to say, you know, how can we help? You know, from quite simply some ceiling tiles. Well, some really nice ceiling tiles that people have in stock that are overstocked from another project that they have in their warehouse. They want to repurpose it and give it to this facility to help out. I believe two-thirds of one of the floors, one vendor came forward with all the carpet on the project. Mm-hmm. That was Atkin Johnson, that they donated to, it was 20,000 square feet of carpet. And, you know, those are the kind of things that people just get it. The community here has been really great when we have that discussion. They understand what we're trying to accomplish, and that is not just another project, another construction job to churn out and try and, you know, make money and just keep doing, but rather there's a purpose to it, and a very good purpose to the project, and that's why we've seen when we've been able to convey that message, it's been received very well.
How does that make you feel to be part of such a great effort?
It's pretty fulfilling. You know, having the opportunity to talk with everybody, to see them, you know, offer up whether it's the money, the materials, or the labor for the project. It's great to have everybody. We've been getting together with them quite often to talk about what it's going to be purposed for. And you see the satisfaction of everybody the same way, that they feel good about what they're doing to help out in the community. It'll be great when the project wraps up and is fully open and ready to go. And that'll be the best part of it, just to help the folks that need it.
Do you know when it will be open?
It'll be May of 2016.
So how did Oz Architecture get involved in it?
Well, we had done a lot of city work, and we were asked to propose on the project. And so we interviewed and found this great group of people that we're interviewing for. And we were fortunate enough that we, I guess, said the right things at the right time. And we knew it was beyond just a building project, as you were saying, that it was really something more. And we really had to concentrate on how to get the building right, the insides right, how to get them to work. So we really touted that part of our portfolio, less so on the building side and the prettiness side of it. And so we concentrated on that, and we were awarded the project, which was great, and you're euphoric after that. But the more we got into it, and the more we met the people and worked with them, it, just like Rob's saying, it was just a joy to work with everybody, knowing you were doing some greater purpose and all that. And I ride my bike a lot. I'm talking to all my biking friends about, hey, here we go. We're doing this great project. And they're asking questions all the time. So you really felt that you were doing something important and a part of the community and everything. So it just kept growing and growing. And it hasn't stopped yet. We still are, you know, just in that state. Just want to get this building up and running and have everybody using it to its ultimate success.
And what about the people using it that'll be helping the people using it, the various nonprofits engaged? Are they very, you know, dialed in as much as the folks that are building the bricks and mortar side of it?
Yeah, they really are dialed in. And I think that, to give you an example of that, San Diego's had one of these for 10, 15 years. And I know their director, the guy that started it, he was their city attorney. I saw him a couple of weeks ago, Casey Gwen. And Casey said, you know, you guys have the partnership, and that's what matters. You just need to get the building done. If we had the partners that you have, and when I'm talking about the shelter and I'm talking about all the different agencies that come together, the nonprofits, all of that, that will be part of this center. That part's been built and been running well for 10 years. It's just, it's not a place. There's not a place for a victim that has suffered a beating, has their kids in tow, to walk in and know they're going to be, like Joe said, safe, secure, and welcome. And they may want to talk to the police, they may not. They may want to talk to the district attorney, they may not. Their issue may be something else. Maybe they're just there to get information. But that's the kind of place this is going to be. And the construction people, the architects, have been incredible. But I can't leave out the fact that Arrow Electronic, Comcast, you know, I talked about the foundation support, but we have business support throughout this that have given us money for the bricks and mortar so we can bring this team, make it happen. And they're there. They're going to provide us in kind, the computers, the electronics, all of those things that are going to make this a modern building. This old building will be a beautiful place. And it's because of the work of these guys. But we've got a lot of partners out there that are saying, yeah, we get it and we want to help. You know, Arrow's brand new to pretty much to Colorado. And they told us, not only do we get it, we need a workforce. And we would love to help train these people when they're through your system so they can come and work for us. Wow. And so we're going to have those kinds of services, probably primarily on the second floor, which for a long time, this team thought we were going to just have to warehouse that. But recently, with the fundraisers that we have that are really incredible, and one of them is my wife, so I have to say that, but she really is incredible. We have somebody that's going to support getting that part of it finished. And so that kicks back a little bit our opening date, but when we open it, the building will be done. And that part of it is the missing piece here that will make Denver's treatment of domestic violence victims so much better.
Along with Maggie Morrissey and Arrow, are there some other shout outs you want to give thanks to?
Well, you know, I'd love to talk a lot about our team that came together from Associated Building Specialties, Academy Roofing, Assurance Fire Sprinklers, American Renaissance, Arrow Electronics, Benjamin Moore, Bowman Construction, Brundage Bone, CFM Company, CMC Rebar, Comcast, Colorado Doorways, Cutting Edge Glass, Edge Construction, Etkin Johnson, Ferguson, Hegem Lundquist, Illumination Systems, IMI Steel, Jones Hearts Drywall, Martin Marietta for Concrete, MNR Specialty Contracting, ProCraft Mechanical, Siemens, SRB Acoustics, Trespa.
Oh my gosh.
We've got it's many, many partners that have
from
that helped out.
To the foundation.
All the way.
Yeah. Have you ever seen anything like this before where the community of the construction community and the architectural community come together in such great force to put together a beautiful building that's so welcoming and so needed in a community?
Yeah. Well, this is very rare. You will get some donations and things for some projects, but the list that Rob has put together is as big as I've ever seen, and just about everybody, like you said, from all walks of life wanting to do that. And I should say what's really unique about this project is that most projects, especially when you're doing a remodel, which there's all this unknown and hidden stuff, you're always fighting the fight, and I'm sure Rob will agree that there's never quite enough money and you're going to find something new, and then what are you going to have to take out because now you have a problem you didn't. Well, Maggie, on her part, always found more money, and the project hasn't gotten smaller. It's gotten bigger and bigger and bigger, and she's always come through. So I said, why don't we see if we could do this? We'll go ahead, design it, Rob will price it, and the money will be there. So it's been like an incredible project because you're not worried about that aspect. Other people are worried, and they're bringing everything to the table they can, and it's just going so smoothly. It's just really working well.
So it's two stories and how many square feet?
Roughly 45,000 square feet of finished space. It also includes three areas for parking that are on the first floor. So that's another roughly 20,000 square feet. So overall, almost 70,000 square feet of space.
And can the client stay overnight there, or is this a place that happens?
No.
Or
no. No. We have the shelter as our partner.
I see.
One thing we told the Golden Triangle, which is a very important part of Denver, obviously, that it will not be like the jail. It will not have 24 hours people going through their neighborhood, that kind of thing. This center may have some evening type training type things, but it's primarily going to be working hours. And we have those partners for shelter. We have those partners, the Dumb Friends League for pets. Mm. I mean, we have a big partnership here of 24 agencies that provide these services. What's great about this is if somebody wants to give a dollar, they can do that. Go on our website, there's a way to donate. But to see the entire Denver community step up like these gentlemen have, and you know, they're part of this list too, it's just been an incredible thing for me to see.
It's amazing. Thank you for the great work that you do. We just have about 30 seconds left. Any final thoughts from each of you?
Well, again, it's just been a pleasure to work on this project with all the great people working on it, and to know that just all these good people can come together and really accomplish something.
Yeah. Rob?
We look forward to finishing the project and opening up in May 2016.
And you'll be invited.
Great.
Yes, we'll hope to see you.
I can't wait to get there. Thank you so much, gentlemen, and for all the great work that you're doing in the community. Very much appreciate it. That wraps it up for this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. We'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.